Our love is alive, and so we begin.
And as the organizing committee, we are very glad to see you all gathered here. In our times is pretty much
you shot me for them, you shot me, then you pass, and I'm like,
let me start the
satisfaction in your eyes. I love you, and I trusted you so well. So,
baby, I see what's on your mind. I see you try to find another lie for me, and when I ask about it,
thank you very much.
When I ask, you're hiding from me. Confusing thoughts and mystery. I see our love was just a fantasy for me. You play me like nobody. When you were everything for me. You shot me so damn well. You dum bum bum. You shot me, then you got me, and I'm like damn. You dum bum bum. I see the satisfaction in your eyes. Dum bum bum.
Format of the board conference, but I would like to say that all the credits of us having this conference and having us here goes, of course, to the wonderful organizing committee, local organizing committee of the conference, who I believe made a heroic effort despite all the pandemic difficulties, both organizational and psychological, to overcome it and to move advance in our communication and in our science to the border of returning back to our usual regular interactions and everyday life. I think it is very important. And I would like to thank very much again all the organizing committee in Nizhny. Second, I would like to thank all of you for attending this conference, because this is also an important psychological step of coming out of our self-isolation. And of course, you, all of us felt that our interactions going into online format are in a way being transformed to weakening. We lack the live exchange of opinions, knowledge, interactions, close contacts. And I hope that at this conference, we will regain this possibility and suggest for all of us to use it 100%. And the third thing which I wanted to say is not related to the event of post-COVID conference. It is actually one of the first offline conferences, scientific conferences being held, but to the content of the program of the conference. We have a set of sessions which are unique in a particular way to neuroscience conferences, especially not a large meeting where thousands of people are running from one hall and one poster to another, but are able to interact physically with each other. Because we have sections covering very different aspects, and some of them are rather new or quite new. The issues of, for example, artificial intelligence in neuroscience is gaining importance, and among neurobiologists and neuroscientists, it is still underrepresented topic. So the fact that we have one of the lines of presentations in this direction makes it very profitable to us who will get the acquaintance with this. Cellular and molecular, together with the computational and cognitive, makes a bridges across different layers of neuroscience. And we have also interesting tradition of biophotonic conferences, which were famous and held by Nizhny Novgorod, also on a boat, to be introduced in our neuroscience meeting as a special session. And finally, the issues of aging, viewed from the broad perspective, not simply of the cognitive or neurobiological aging. I think everything of this can enrich our interaction. So I welcome and call your enthusiasm to these lectures, talks, posters, and of course, real life interaction in the advance of our field. Thank you.
And now, with a great pleasure, I invite to say the opening words the rector of Lobachevsky University of Nizhny Novgorod, the member of the Russian Academy of Science, Елена Загайнова.
Dear colleagues, dear friends, and I think all of you are scientists, first of all. It's my pleasure to say welcome to our conference, unfortunately not on a boat, not on a Volga River, but on Oka River. Oka River is maybe not worse than the Volga River, and that's why I think that your conference will be maybe better than the previous. But also I, as the one organizer of the Biophotonics Conference, I want to give you some task, because this year we could not provide our conference on board, unfortunately. And that's why we have very difficult task to combine the biophotonics and neuro task, and maybe I'll find the new approach in neuroscience. And also as a rector of University of Lobachevsky, I also hope that you help us to renew our neuroscience. What I mean, you know, 10 years ago, the Lobachevsky University was same use university of neuroscience investigations and new approaches, new projects, and so on. Some years ago, unfortunately, neuroscience go down. It's my dream that your conference will be the beginning of new life of neuroscience in our famous university. And that's why it's a very difficult task for you, and my wishes for you to renew the neuroscience in our Lobachevsky University. And also I want to say many thanks to our guests, to our famous professors who have an opportunity to visit and give the famous lecture about the new problem in neuroscience. And also, of course, I say many thanks to all guests who come to us from Moscow, St. Petersburg, or even from foreign countries. And I wish you a very interesting conference, meetings, making new friends, and maybe most I wish you to find new ideas and new groups, new teams, with which you will work together. And I hope that you will work to our famous team in the University of Lobachevsky. That's why I wish you a good work, good job, good friends, good weather, because yeah, you are outside and that's why you have the opportunity to go for a walk and have a brilliant scientific discussion, I hope. And what else I want to wish you? I wish you to continue next time, again on boat, on Volga River. And we hope that COVID fine, and we will organize the next conference on a boat. It's most better than in the hotel because you have an opportunity to see our famous views of a Volga River or a Oka River or some lakes, and you have close community on a boat and have rarely opportunity to speak about science, life, love, and something else. I wish you good luck in your conference.
Thank you very much. Indeed, we tried it so hard to make a balance between the dance program, which I hope you will enjoy a lot, and some relaxation. So indeed, our aim was to create an atmosphere when you can make science, but not only science. As a sort of a bit promotion for the poster session that will be tomorrow, I can announce that it will be held in maybe more typically German style, at least which I used to have. So please attend, and I hope you will be quite inspired to make scientific discussions. I hope that in spite of this luxurious environment here, the lectures and the plenary lectures will be more attractive than sunbathing and swimming. And I hope that this some of you will find some compromise, of course. So without much further words, I will announce their first session and the only session for the today. And I will give the floor to the chair of this session, Professor Viktor Trabekin.
So thank you. This is my real pleasure to chair the first post-COVID offline session, scientific session. And it will start with a memorial lecture of Alexander Petrenko, who was supposed to come also, but he died a few months ago. And before we start the scientific part, I'll give the floor to my good friend and colleague who knew Alexander very well, and he will say a few words about him. This is Kerim Mutik.
Just waiting for technical stuff here. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues and friends, let me say a couple of words about my friend Alexander Georgievich Petrenko. As I first met him, how can I switch the slides? So as I first met him, he introduced himself as Sasha. He was a open-minded and friendly person. He invited me to Moscow. He has picked me up personally at the airport and brought to his house. That was a wonderful time. Next, please. During subsequent several years of our collaboration, I have visited Moscow several times. And I have also sent my students to his lab for internships. Sasha was a dedicated teacher, a talented scientist, and an internationally dynamic person, but he was also a real Russian soul. So he has spent several years of his career in US and then returned back to Moscow. You can see here his lab members and also some informal activities with his lab members. Next, please. Next, please. Sasha has spent much time in his lab and he dedicated himself to force the development of young people in his lab. So as an example of that, please, next slide. You can see here Igor Deev, a postdoctoral fellow in his lab, who has published a first author paper in a top international journal, Cell Metabolism. So people under the guidance of Sasha received international recognition. Next, please. Later, my own doctoral student, Torsten Giesecke, enjoyed nice and fruitful time in Sasha's lab, which helped him a lot to publish his paper on the regulation of the acid-base homeostasis and also to defend his thesis with excellence. Next, please. So here you see that paper. And I have also to say that Sasha has worked in different fields. So one of his research activities was the regulation of acid-base balance, which has inspired me to contact Sasha. And then also Torsten Giesecke has taken advantage of the expertise of Sasha. So dear colleagues, talking about my personal impression, Sasha was a wonderful personality, a talented scientist, and had a great potential to motivate and inspire people. I deeply regret that he passed away so early due to a severe course of COVID infections. And so thank you for your attention.
Born in Germany. Can you
hear me, Tom? Can you hear me? Barely. Okay, now can you hear me? I guess Tom can hear me too. Yes. So Thomas Zuthof was born in Germany in the city of Göttingen. And then he studied medicine. But as far as I know, he never practiced as a doctor. He immediately got inspired by science and he started to work as a scientist. And then he moved to the States after completing his medical degree in Germany. He moved to Texas, University of Texas. And there he worked in the field of LDL receptor biochemistry. So LDLs are low density lipoprotein receptors, very famous molecules that are important for cholesterol metabolism. And these were instrumental to discover the mechanism of endocytosis. And I guess this is what inspired him after he started his independent lab also in Texas. This has inspired him to study something which was at that time, more than 30 years ago, neglected in the field of neuroscience, and namely presynaptic mechanisms of synaptic transmission. And there he discovered a number of molecules, maybe all molecules that are important for neurotransmitter release, synaptotagmin among them, MANC proteins, parts of snare complex. He also discovered a number of proteins that are important for synapse formation, neurexins and neuroregulins. And his tremendous efforts in this field were recognized in 2013 when he was awarded a Nobel Prize in Medicine and Physiology. So Tom, I hope you can hear me and thank you very much for accepting our invitation. And I'm looking forward to your talk.
Thank you. I will try to share my screen. Hopefully that will work. Okay. Can you see this? Is this visible? No response.
We can, Tom, we can see it.
Good.
So sorry, the microphones were not on.
Okay, good. Okay, so I would like to thank Victor and everybody else to have me not physically there, but virtually, and to allow me to present to you a little bit of our work in honor of Sasha Petrenko. Before I start, I would like to say a few words about my relationship with Sasha. So as you may know, Sasha came to my lab as a senior scientist in 1990, after the Soviet Union disintegrated. And what you see here is a picture from approximately 1994, just before he left. And what you can see there is Sasha. And this picture is a picture of my lab at the time. Obviously, everybody else, as well as Sasha, moved on at some point. This is me, by the way, just slightly younger. When Sasha came to my lab, he came together with his partner in science at that time, Yuri Ushkaryov. And together they worked in my lab on proteins that bound to alpha-lactotoxin, a project that they had initiated at the Shemyakin. And that really was instrumental in many ways in opening up a new field. And their work laid the foundation to much of what has developed since. Both of them were later followed by other colleagues from the Shemyakin, including Kostya Ichchenko, who is also on this image. Yuri is not, I don't know why not. And Bazbek was not on this image. I've worked since then on many different projects, but I've talked to Sasha repeatedly over the years. I followed his career first at New York University and later on in Moscow. And I visited him in 2017, the last time I actually saw him, sadly. This picture was taken as I was on my way out of Moscow. In fact, this was, as you probably recognize, in a metro station in Moscow on the way to the airport. I remember that occasion very much because it was really a great visit. I haven't been to Moscow very often, twice in my life, I believe. And I've always enjoyed my visits. And Sasha was a fantastic host during my short time in 2017. So I think we will all miss him for a number of reasons. He was most of all what they call in German and in Yiddish, same word, a mensch, which basically means that he was truly into things and participating and engaged and honestly taking part in everything with a high degree of integrity. And that part is what I miss most. Although, of course, as you all know, he was a very creative and very talented scientist, a good mentor, somebody who I think will be missed by many, many people. So in today's talk, I would like to pay homage to Sasha and his work by telling you about our studies on synapse formation, studies that owe a lot to some of his most pioneering original experiments. In order to frame what I'm going to tell you, let me remind you about something that you all know anyway, which is that the brain is insanely complex. What you see here is an image of a human brain postmortem. You all know that there is trillions of neurons in the brain that are connected via synapses into vast networks. The exact number is unclear, but 10 to the 15 to 10 to the 16 synapses is probably not an overestimate. Compared to the human genome that contains less than 10 to the 10 base pairs of DNA, much of which is not even coding, the human brain is insanely complex. And because of that, people often argue how and if we can understand it, what's the best way of approaching its study. There's one concept I think that everybody agrees on, which is the concept of neural circuits. And that concept is schematically illustrated in this slide here, which shows a microcircuit of feed-forward inhibition. A microcircuit composed of two excitatory neurons that are synaptically connected and one red inhibitory neuron that is excited by the left excitatory neuron and inhibits the right neuron. Circuits process information via synapses, and what you see on top here is an electron micrograph of a synapse. And synapses are the fundamental computational unit of the brain. It's not the neuron, as many computational neuroscientists would like to believe. It is really the synapse that processes, changes information, doesn't just transmit it. Just to give you an example of some synaptic computations, what you see here is an image taken from a very, relatively speaking, old review article by Atwood and Karunanithi. And you can see connections in the cortex and cerebellum illustrated schematically. On the left, you have two. You have a pyramidal neuron that forms excitatory synapses on two interneurons. And what this illustrates is that these excitatory synapses, although by the same presynaptic neuron, have different short-term plasticity. Meaning short-term plasticity, which is generally, probably falsely, thought to be a presynaptic phenomenon, is instructed by the postsynaptic neuron. On the right, conversely, you see the famous connections of parallel fiber and climbing fibers with Purkinje cells in the cerebellum. And again, you have synapses this time on the same postsynaptic neuron that have completely different forms of synaptic plasticity, short-term synaptic plasticity. The lesson or message here is that synapse properties, illustrated here only for one particular property, short-term plasticity, are controlled not just by one partner in a synapse, but they're controlled by the interaction of pre- and postsynaptic neurons. And this is just one example of properties of synapses that illustrate information processing. And this type of information processing has deep implications for how we think, just very, very, very simplistically. If we assume this was a facilitating synapse and that an inhibitory, a depressing synapse, then only high frequency signals would be transmitted and vice versa. So the actual processing, even in such a simple circuit, cannot be predicted from the circuit wiring diagram, but the synapses process information. It's not only important in circuits to understand how synapses connect neurons into circuits, but it is also important the specific properties of these synapses. And synapses are dynamic. Both their very existence as well as their properties changes continuously. I'm telling you all this because I wanted to make you sort of remind you that we cannot treat synapses static elements. Instead, we have to consider synapses at the very heart of understanding how the brain processes information. And what we want to do in our lab at this point is to describe one particular feature of how synapses wire circuits. And that is, we would like to learn more about the molecular rules that underlie the formation of synapses and their continuous reformation, their continuous changes, their continuous specification, their plasticity. That is the goal that we are pursuing, broadly speaking, in my lab. And the fundamental proposition that we are proposing here is that synapses are specialized intercellular junctions that connect pre and postsynaptic neurons in the brain, and that are controlled by bidirectional signaling by a transsynaptic adhesion molecules. In other words, the way a synapse knows how to behave, the way how a postsynaptic and a presynaptic neuron signal to each other to assume certain properties instructed by their more central nuclei and other features, is via adhesion molecules whose primary function is not to adhere, but to signal. This bidirectional signaling forms and maintains synapses. It continuously restructures them, it organizes their elimination. It organizes the presynaptic release machinery, and it recruits and regulates postsynaptic receptors. And many candidate synaptic adhesion molecules are described. What you see here is a schematic view of some of them taken from one of my reviews. It shows on the left the presynaptic and on the right the postsynaptic side. It shows with the arrows connections. It's extremely schematic. Most of these proteins, we don't know what they do. You can see immediately that the presynaptic side contains more hub molecules that are connected to many postsynaptic molecules. And the overall program we are pursuing in our lab is to try to understand which of these proteins are actually important and what they do. We aim for a vertically integrated understanding that includes insight into the atomic mechanisms, what they actually look like in three-dimensional space using structural biology, but also insight into how specific molecules and their variants control synapses, and by controlling particular synapses, instruct neural circuits. And this is the overall goal of the lab. I'm not going to tell you an overview of the entire program. It would be too much. Instead, I want to talk about one particular family of proteins that we've been especially interested in recently. And I want to also talk about these molecules because Sasha had a major part in their initial discovery. And these are latrophilins, which are postsynaptic molecules, as I will describe, that interact with a number of presynaptic molecules, including neurexins, which are hub molecules that I won't discuss today, but that are central to understanding synapses. Just by way of introduction, the reason, as I already mentioned, for me to talk here on latrophilins is because Sasha Petrenko and Yuri Ushkaryov, when they left my lab, they went to different places to assume faculty positions. But both purified the first latrophilin immediately after they left my lab on a mobilized alpha-latrotoxin on a column. And they postulated based on that, that this would be novel latrotoxin receptors in addition to neurexins, which are genuine latrotoxin receptors that directly bind latrotoxin with nanomolar affinity and that mediate the action of latrotoxin. So the initial idea was that latrophilins, which Sasha, who actually had the first paper called SIL, calcium-independent receptor for latrotoxin. The immediate idea was that there would also be presynaptic latrotoxin receptors, something that was also our idea until about 10 years ago, when we discovered, as I will describe to you, that in truth, they are postsynaptic receptors instead of presynaptic, and are probably not latrotoxin receptors, but we can talk about that. Okay, so my talk will have three parts, the actual data. First, latrophilins control formation and specificity of synapses. Second, how they do it via extracellular interactions. And third, and shortest, that they actually function as GPCRs. To start at the beginning, I have to give you some more introduction to latrophilins. Latrophilins were the first, I believe, well-characterized adhesion GPCRs. And as adhesion GPCRs, they are composed of a canonical set of domains that is illustrated here on the example of latrophilins. Extracellular, as you see here on top, they contain ligand binding domains. These are different between different types of adhesion GPCRs. In the middle, in light green highlighted, are the canonical adhesion GPCR domains that all adhesion GPCRs have. A so-called gain domain and a seven transmembrane region architecture that is canonical for all GPCRs. Intracellularly, latrophilins, like other adhesion GPCRs, contain a large cytoplasmic sequence. The canonical adhesion GPCR domains, gain domain and seven transmembrane regions, are particularly noteworthy because obviously hundreds of proteins contain seven transmembrane region GPCR architectures, but only adhesion GPCRs and one other class of proteins, which I won't mention, contain gain domains. And in fact, gain domains are really special. We identified gain domains about 10 years ago in a collaboration with Axel Bringer, when we tried to identify the domains of latrophilin. Gain domains, as it turns out, and as we hadn't anticipated, are the defining feature of adhesion GPCRs. Adhesion GPCRs likely act as true GPCRs. But physiological evidence is lacking for most adhesion GPCRs, and nothing is known about how their GPCR activity is regulated. The gain domain is at the center of all current concept at adhesion GPCRs because the gain domain is an autoproteolysis domain. It's a domain, as we showed about 10 years ago, that mediates catalytic cleavage and thereby causes latrophilin and other adhesion GPCRs to be cleaved into two parts, an extracellular part and an intracellular part. And the whole idea is that the gain domain autoproteolytic cleavage may be involved in activating adhesion GPCRs, although that is not known. So what makes the gain domain so special? What you see here is the adhesion as a latrophilin one gain domain whose structure, as I mentioned before, we determined in collaboration with Axel Bringer's lab 2011. The postdoc at that time, Demet Arak, was a fantastic structural biologist who has since established very successfully her own lab at the University of Chicago and continues to work on these problems. What you see is the gain domain is composed of two folds that are closely connected, a subdomain A and B. The subdomain B contains the cleavage site. The asterisk indicates where the cleavage occurs. The blue piece is the N-terminus, the new N-terminus, the C-terminal little finger that remains after cleavage. And that remains stuck in the pocket. The idea is that the finger remains stuck in the pocket and that the two domains remain attached to each other. But several people have proposed that the GPCRs are activated when ligands pull off the gain domain and thereby expose the remaining finger that then serves as a tethered agonist that is basically detached, and that is referred to in German as Stachel. That is the idea. It's a great idea. It's very plausible, and it is likely to be true for some GPCRs, but it's equally possible that some or all act by a different mechanism. However, the gain domain is clearly at the center of all understanding of adhesion GPCRs. Now let me get back to the lotophilins in particular and describe to you the actual adhesion domains they have. These are, as I mentioned, at the N-terminus and are composed of a lectin-like domain at the very N-terminus and an affectamidin-like domain, in addition to other domains that are shown below those framed domains and that are not important for today's discussion. These two domains bind to different ligands in that the lectin-like domain with high affinity binds to tenuins and the olfactomedin-like domain with high affinity binds to flows. And we, again, in collaboration with Demet Arak, as well as others, determined the structures of these complexes, validating them as truly existing complexes that operate to connect latrophilin-containing cells with other cells into adhesion, adhering cells, adhesion junctions. And these, by the way, are not only important for the brain, but have general functions during development in many tissues. Latrophilins are not different from neurexins, neuron-specific or brain-specific. Recording stopped, recording in progress. Okay. Latrophilins were purified thus as alpha-latotoxin binding proteins, suggesting a synaptic role and specifically a presynaptic role. But what do they actually do? And we struggled with this. We made the first latrophilin 1 knockout more than 20 years ago and studied it, but were not very successful because at that point, we didn't have the expertise to really analyze synaptic adhesion molecules. And more recently, we made conditional knockouts of all the latrophilins to study them. And when we studied them, the first thing we observed was surprising. And that is illustrated in this slide here. And that was that latrophilins are, in fact, postsynaptic adhesion molecules that are important for synapse formation. And let me explain this to you in a little more detail. What we did here is we sparsely transfected conditional latrophilin 2 knockout neurons cultured from the hippocampus with Cre that deletes latrophilin 1, 2, or delta Cre, which is a control, a mutant Cre, just to make sure that we wouldn't be biased. And then we analyzed these neurons using either electrophysiology or morphology. And you can see here that in morphology measurements that determine spine density, the latrophilin 2 knockout caused a massive, unprecedented, in fact, reduction in spines. And as it turns out, that correlates with a reduction in synapse numbers. This was unprecedented because we have no other knockout in our hands at this point, and we know of no other knockout that causes a similar decrease. There's a lot of RNAi experiments in the literature that suggest similar decreases for innumerable molecules. But when we tested some of these molecules in real knockouts, they never do this. So this was, at this point, quite unique and told us two things. One thing, this is a postsynaptic molecule. This can't be a presynaptic latotoxin receptor. And its mechanism to the latotoxin column is probably independent of latotoxin binding. And second, it's involved in synapse formation in some way, directly and indirectly. And this observation formed the nucleus of a number of experiments that happened since then. Based on these results, we initiated a comprehensive analysis of latrophilins in vivo in the hippocampus. using conditional knock-in mice expressing epitope tag proteins, we haven't analyzed autofillin 1 yet. These experiments are focused on 2 and 3, and I forgot to mention there's 3 isoforms. When we analyze the distribution of autofillins 2 and 3 in the hippocampus, as shown here, illustrated on the left in a representative picture and shown on the quantifications on the right, we found that autofillin 2, shown in green, is selectively expressed only in the stratum lacunosum malocalara of the CA1 region, whereas autofillin 3 was present throughout the stratum oriens and stratum radiatum, but excluded from the stratum lacunosum malocalara. It is again present in the dentate gyrus. This suggested that the two latrophilins are present in different dendritic domains of the same postsynaptic CA1 neuron, and suggested that they may have distinct functions. Now, as it turns out, these two different locations correspond to distinct hippocampal circuits. You probably all know that a simplified view of the hippocampal circuit as illustrated here suggests that there's a trisynaptic red circuit that sends information from the entoanal cortex via the granule cells in the dentate gyrus, the CA3 region and the CA1 region, as well as a direct pathway shown in blue from the entoanal cortex to the CA1 region. The point here is that the direct blue pathway, where it synapses only on the stratum lacunosum molecularum of the dendritic, of the dendrites of CA1 neurons, whereas the Schaffer collateral trisynaptic pathway synapses onto the stratum radiatum and the stratum oriens where the latrophilin 3 is localized. So these two localizations correspond to distinct circuits. To test whether these localizations also correspond to functions of the latrophilins in these different circuits, we used in vivo manipulations. We used sparse infections in vivo of the hippocampus at P0, as shown here in blue on the left, CA1 region. And then 3 weeks later, 3 to 4 weeks later, we cut slices from these mice, we patched the neurons, and we analyzed them both morphologically by filling them with biocytin, as well as electrophysiologically. And doing these types of experiments, we found that the latrophilin 2 knockout had no effect on spine numbers in the stratum radiatum and oriens, but decreased the spine numbers and synapse numbers significantly and selectively in the stratum lacunosum molecularum, which is obviously where the molecule is localized. Electrophysiologically, we can measure the inputs of both Schaffer collaterals and entorhinal cortex afferents using stimulation and recordings from the same neurons as illustrated here schematically. And when we did this, we found that stratum radiatum Schaffer collateral stimulation shows an increase in synaptic strength, not a decrease, an increase that we believe may be compensatory, whereas the entorhinal cortex synaptic strength is massively decreased, as would be expected from a decrease in synapse numbers. So overall, this confirms that latrophilin 2 acts selectively in mediating synapse formation or maintenance in the stratum lacunosum molecularum via a postsynaptic action of CA1 region neurons. What about this latrophilin 3? Does it do the same thing? What you see here is again the same picture I showed you earlier, just to remind you of the experimental paradigm, but now we are analyzing latrophilin 3 mice. And what you see here is that when we mutate latrophilin 3, we see a partial reduction in spine numbers, now in the stratum oriens and stratum radiatum, but not in the stratum lacunosum molecularum. And when we analyze this by electrophysiology, we see a massive decrease in synaptic strength and Schaffer collaterals, but not in the performed capacity. Now there is no compensatory increase. So these experiments confirm that serlatophilin 2 and 3 are postsynaptic adhesion molecules that selectively essential for synaptic inputs at distinct dendritic domains of the same CA1 pyramidal neurons, suggesting that they're involved in establishing and maintaining synapses as postsynaptic molecules that act to specify particular presynaptic inputs. And this concludes the first part. Let me move on and now tell you about how we think that might work. And in order to analyze this, we used rescue experiments with defined mutations, both in vitro in culture and in vivo. What you see here on the left is a schematic of latrophilin's structure and the mutations that we analyzed. One mutation contains substitutions, amino acid substitutions in the alpha-actamidin-like domain that abolish flirt binding. The other mutant contains a deletion of the lectin-like domain that abolishes tenurin binding. And the third mutant contains a point mutation in the gain domain that abolishes autoproteolysis, meaning the protein is no longer cleaved. There is no longer an ability to tear it apart and expose an agonist. We tested these different molecules first in vitro and also analyzed them structurally and found that they had no effects, that the mutations had no effects on folding, that the molecules were still able, the mutant molecules, to engage in transcellular adhesions with partners that could still be bound after the mutations, such as, for example, the flirts and the tenulin mutants, as shown here in the delta lec mutation. We then used these mutants for rescue experiments. And what we found in vitro, as shown here, is, as you can see here in this quantification, of minis, spontaneous miniature EPSCs, that the wild type shown in blue completely rescued. The loss of minis observed upon Cre-dependent deletion of latrophilin 3, but that both the mutation that abolishes flirt binding and the mutation that abolishes tenurin binding does abolishes rescue or severely decreases rescue, whereas the mutation that abolishes autoproteolysis does not. And I apologize, I haven't looked at the slide before. The left shows synapse density, the right shows the mini frequency. My apologies here. I got a little ahead of myself. So just to repeat what you see on the left are the excitatory synapses visualized by immunocytochemistry. On the right, the minis. In both cases, we are analyzing rescue. In both cases, the blue wild-type latrophilin 3 completely rescues, the mutant rescues less, mostly indistinguishable from the Cre, as far as the tenurin or the flirt binding was abolished, but the autoproteolysis mutant fully rescues. As you can see on the right, for the minis, the mutants don't rescue at all, but the proteolysis mutant almost completely rescues. What this means is that both mutations impair rescue, that both mutations that abolish ligand binding impair rescue, whereas the mutation that abolishes autoproteolysis does not impair rescue. And in other words, it suggests that autoproteolysis is not required for the synaptic function of latrophilin 3. Which basically means that in this case, at least, it can't be the tethered ligand, the Stachel, that mediates the action. Although that doesn't exclude that in other cases, it might. So the next question that arose from this is whether the flirt and tenurin binding sites are also essential in vivo situations. And so we analyzed this by in vivo rescue. What you see here is rescue experiments where these experiments were performed by injecting animals at P0 with Cree and Delta Cree as a control and the various rescue constructs using lentiviral delivery, and then analysis and acute slices at 3 to 4 weeks later. And you can see here, measured by input-output curves, that Cree, as I mentioned earlier, causes a massive reduction in synaptic strength, as analyzed here in the Schaffer collateral synapses in lactoferrin and 3 situations. Wild-type rescues this, but both mutants that abolish ligand binding fail to rescue. So both binding mutants of lactoferrin 3 cannot rescue lactoferrin 3 knockout phenotype. Both ligands must bind. To test this conclusion with an independent method, because this is really central for understanding, and to test whether this involves synaptic connections and not just synaptic function, as it would, for example, for orexins, where synaptic connections are normal, we used as an independent approach retrograde pseudotyped rabies tracing to quantify synaptic connectivity. I'm sure you're familiar with this method that was discovered or invented in Ed Calloway's lab about 10 years ago. Its pioneering nature is illustrated on the right, as you can see here. You basically see the starter cells in CA1, and then you can analyze input connections via green fluorescent labeling, as shown here in the middle panel in green. And as you can see, the CA1 neurons in a mouse contain the same number of inputs, synaptic inputs, via Schaffer collaterals from the CA3 region of both brain regions, of both sides, the CA3 region of the of the ipsilateral and of the contralateral side. And you can quantify this. Whereas the entorhinal cortex to a CA1 region neuron are only ipsilateral, not contralateral, as shown on the right. So this enables us to quantify the number of inputs, the amount of inputs to a given set of CA1 neurons, enables us to test lactoferrin 3 function. And this is quantified here. You can see that on the right, the quantifications, the ipsilateral CA3 region, Cree largely abolishes Schaffer collateral inputs. These are rescued in blue by the wild type lactoferrin 3, but not by the ligand binding defective lactoferrins. And this is also true for the contralateral side, not surprisingly, because this is a postsynaptic adhesion molecule, but is not true for the entorhinal cortex input. Now, one thing that you might ask at this point is the presynaptic inputs must be mediated by binding then of tenuins presynaptically to postsynaptic lactoferrins and of presynaptic fluid to postsynaptic lactoferrins. But there's a huge literature concluding that tenuins direct synapse specificity via homophilic tenurin-tenurin binding. In fact, Nature published multiple papers from my own institution on this. 3 papers basically saying that homophilic lactoferrin interactions enable specificity of synaptic connectivity in constructing synaptic circuits. And so this posed a problem for us, because how is it possible that presynaptic tenuins mediate specificity in synaptic connections and mediate synapse formations by binding to postsynaptic lactoferrins if they bind to postsynaptic tenuins? Now, when you look into these papers, it turns out that there was no mechanistic test of the hypothesis. There was all 3 papers were correlative. And so we try to address this directly by testing whether postsynaptic tenuins are actually essential for the synaptic connectivity using postsynaptic deletions of tenuins 3 and 4. And as you can see here in experiments, that are unpublished, we found that postsynaptic deletion of 10 neurons has no effect on synaptic connectivity whatsoever, quantified, demonstrating that there's no effect, whereas presynaptic deletions of 10 neurons not shown abolishes synaptic connectivity, suggesting that indeed the key here is a heterophilic interaction and not a homophilic interaction. So this argues obviously against the postsynaptic role of 10 neurons. Presynaptic deletion, as I mentioned, however, blocks synapse formation. So back to the question then, why are two ligand binding sites required for 10 neurons, for latofilins? Why do you need both the binding site for 10 neuron and for lateral for FLIRTs? And so there's possible coincidence signaling via multiple ligands as a mechanism of circuit assembly that we would like to propose and that we illustrate here in this schematic that includes some of the structures we and others obtained. And it shows the 10 neuron structure in green, and 10 neuron binds to latrophilins as well as FLIRTs. Now FLIRTs, as I haven't mentioned, also bind to another adhesion molecule called UNC5 that is presumably postsynaptic, although we don't know that for sure. And together these complexes are then proposed to mediate synapse formation by inducing signaling. And they are proposed to do so by activating some kind of signal, which I'll come back to in a minute. Now, one thing I didn't mention up to now is that 10 neurons preferentially bind latrophilins in a manner that is dictated or regulated by alternative splicing of 10 neurons, in that SS minus preferentially binds 10 neurons, whereas SS plus does not. And so we tested this further, this whole idea, using the artificial synapse formation assay. And this artificial synapse formation assay involves the expression of cell adhesion molecules in Hex cells, and then the co-culture of the Hex cells with neurons, and the measurement of synapses formed onto the Hex cells. This is a very artificial assay. It's not very predictive for synapse formation, but it's useful because it's simple. And so we use this assay to measure the synapse formation induced by 10 neurons or FLIRTs to test whether they individually would actually form induce synapses. And what you can see here on the slide is that under controls, as shown here in the PSD95 postsynaptic marker staining, the control has no synapses. Neurexin 1 beta, which is a presynaptic adhesion molecule, forms synapses. 10 neurons does not. When it's alone, FLIRT does not. When it's alone, 10 neurons when it's in the SS minus does. 10 neurons when it's in the SS plus does not. So this suggests that there's a requirement for both 10 neurons and FLIRTs as presynaptic adhesion molecules to induce postsynaptic specializations. And you can quantify this as shown here. Neurexin 1 beta serves as a positive control. FLIRTs and 10 neurons don't do anything. 10 neuron does it as SS minus, whereas 10 neuron SS plus has an effect, but it's much less than 10 neuron SS minus and only in combination with FLIRTs, supporting the hypothesis, by no means proving that, as shown in this slide here, the interactions of 10 neurons with both FLIRTs and of latrophilins with both FLIRTs and 10 neurons at the same time is necessary in order to induce synapse formation. Okay. So this leads us to the hypothesis that latrophilins direct specificity of synaptic connections by coincidence detections of two ligands in an isoform-specific manner, and raises the question, the last bit of my talk and the shortest, you will be happy to hear, raises the question of how do latrophilins work? Is GPCR signaling essential for latrophilin function? And so to address this, we again used the rescue approach. And we again used several mutants, and these mutants are illustrated again in this schematic. One mutant has no transmembrane regions, so it can't transduce any signals. It can only adhere. It can only be adhesion. The other mutant is an insertion of T4 ligase, T4 lysozyme, into the cytoplasmic third loop. It doesn't bind to G proteins or arrestins and blocks GPCR signaling. And the third mutant just cuts off part of the cytoplasmic tail. And we use these, all of these mutants, but the key mutant is the one that abolishes G protein and arrestin binding. Surface transport and ligand binding of these mutants is unimpaired. So they go fine to the surface and they bind ligands. This is illustrated here in showing that they're properly targeted to synapses or to dendritic spines, as illustrated in experiments where we show surface expression of latrophilins that were expressed by viruses in cultured hippocampal neurons. Now, the one big question going into this is whether latrophilins actually contain GPCR activity, which has never been shown, and whether as GPCRs, this GPCR activity can be blocked by this T4 lysozyme insertion. And so to test this, we used transfected Hex cells, and we measured cyclic AMP levels in these transfected Hex cells as a function of latrophilin expression. We measured both cyclic AMP levels and protein kinase A activity. And what you can see here on the left is that if we expressed latrophilins alone together with G alpha S, as you can see in blue and purple, latrophilin 2 and latrophilin 3 had GPCR activity. This GPCR activity was blocked by co-expression of phosphodiesterase, well, not the GPCR activity, the increase in cyclic AMP levels, of course, was blocked by phosphodiesterase, as you would expect, and the GPCR activity was blocked by the T4 ligase lysozyme insertion. The same pattern is observed for protein kinase A activity, demonstrating that, as you can see here for latrophilin 2 and for latrophilin 3, that in both cases, there is GPCR activity that in the presence of G alpha S results in an increase in cyclic AMP, and that is blocked by T4 lysozyme insertion mutations. And so this enables us to test this for function in vivo and in culture using rescue experiments. What you see here are culture experiments measuring either synapse density or mini frequency, as I illustrated to you earlier in rescue experiments, for latrophilin 3, demonstrating that wild-type latrophilin 3 rescues the defect in synapse density and in MEPSC frequency. This rescue is abolished by all mutations that block signaling, either the loss of all transmembrane regions or the T4 lysozyme insertion or the cutting off of the cytoplasmic tail, demonstrating that they indeed function as signaling molecules and not just as adhesive molecules. What about in vivo? To measure this in vivo, we did the usual experiments in vivo PZO injections, P21 analysis by electrophysiology, recording input-output ratios. What you can see here, that doing these experiments for latrophilin 2 knockouts and latrophilin 2 rescue, there's no effect on Schaffer collaterals because that's not where latrophilin is. It's in stratum lacunosum molecularis where the perforin path impacts from the entorhinal cortex. So there's no phenotype in the Schaffer collateral, but in the perforin path, there's a decrease, as I illustrated you earlier. This is rescued with wild type, but not with the T4 lysozyme insertion that selectively blocks G protein signaling. Moving to lotofilin 3, same picture emerges, except now we are looking at sharper collateral phenotypes rescued by wild type, but not by the G protein coupling, defective mutant, no effect on the perforin path as expected. Finally, using virus tracing, rabies virus, pseudotyped rabies virus tracing as an alternative approach, what you see here on the left is the method, on the right is the summary. Again, same story. There's a decrease in the knockout, as illustrated earlier, in this case, looking at lotofilin 3 and sharper collateral. This is selectively rescued by wild type, but not when you block G-protein coupling. So what these slides demonstrate, what this talk should then illustrate to you, is that lotofilins are adhesion GPCRs that in brain, in neurons, as one function, possibly only function, but certainly the dominant function, mediate the establishment of specific synaptic connections via binding to multiple ligands, and that this involves a GPCR activation, but may not require autoproteolysis, and thus may operate by a different mechanism. The details of how this works are obviously going to be interesting and are questions that we are currently working on. And to finish my talk, I would like to acknowledge the major players in what I discussed today, in particular, key people for the lotofilin 3 work, and most of the second half of my discussion were Rick Sandor, who is now an assistant professor at Vanderbilt University and who was tremendously helped by contributions by Shen Zhang and Chu-Chin Zhang. Key person for the lotofilin 2 part of this experiments was Garrett Anderson, who really pioneered much of what I discussed today originally, and who is now an assistant professor at the University of California at Riverside, and who was greatly assisted, as well as Rick Sandor, by a medical student, Shalika Cornelius, who did a fantastic job. And the initial project of lotofilins and their bindings to tenuins were performed by Anthony Bucar, who is now, I believe, an associate professor at the University of Mexico in Mexico City. And finally, we've had innumerable collaborators on this work, in particular, Xiaowei Zhuang, who has been helping us with the super-resolution microscopy, which I haven't discussed. And Demet Arak, who's been a continuous collaborator in our studies and without whom I believe we would know nothing about the gain domain. And the funding for our studies came largely from NIMH and HHMI. And I'm happy to take any questions you might have if there's time. And thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Tom, for this great talk. And I'm pretty sure there are questions, so we have time for questions. Please, student questions first. Don't be shy. So please come to the microphone.
Yes, I will start about from the student question, actually, because since I'm not a student, but I do not understand pretty much in this. But you told us that the synapses are both affected by the presynaptic and postsynaptic neurons, and that they are dynamical. This means that during the some events, the properties can also be changed. And what is my interest is, for example, since I'm involved in epilepsy study, is what can be the some maybe microcircuits and something else. Is there possible that there would can be some few backward loops which can affect the seizure onset or seizure offset in some microcircuits in involved in hippocampus, for example, in limbic epilepsy?
It's a great question, and I have to say outright, I know nothing about epilepsy, so I can only speculate. But from what I remember, there's overwhelming evidence that apsy-epilepsy involves restructuring of synapses, changes plasticity to a large degree. And obviously that will have a major impact on possibly recurrent excitation in micro and even macro circuits. In other words, it's easily imaginable, although I don't know if it's true, that such changes would enhance the probability of recurrent excitation and thereby epileptogenesis, but I don't know if that's actually the case.
So, more questions? Well, the students are thinking, so I have a couple of questions. The first question, most of your talk was about this sparse knockouts. So what would happen if you knock out latrophilin in the entire hippocampus? Is it going to be worse or better?
Great question. Haven't done this. It would actually be worthwhile to test this. There are ways of doing this by using driver lines that specifically knock out latrophilins in particular subsets of neurons in brain. But we haven't done that experiment. I don't know if the phenotype would be less or more severe. There has been speculation and actually evidence that when you put neurons into competition with others and you disadvantage one neuron, that you get restructuring of circuits. And that is probably true, because neurons compete with each other in a homeostatic manner. And so this is certainly an experiment that would be worthwhile doing.
Once the synapses are established, do you need latrophilin fluorotenurine interaction for maintenance of the synapses?
Oh, absolutely, you do, yeah. But you know, there's fantastic work both from Mark Schnitzer at Stanford as well as from just slipping on the name in Bordeaux, demonstrating that in the hippocampus, at least in the CA1 region, something like 40% of all synapses turn over every 2 to 3 weeks in the adult. So maintenance of synapses is a dynamic process. I know that we're used from work in the cortex by Gunn and Svoboda and others to think that synapses are stable. I'm not sure that that's true, because in vivo imaging in other brain regions, such as the hippocampus, has suggested that synapse maintenance may differ between other structures. And I'm not sure how actually stable synapses really are. In my view, most likely synapses are continuously restructured, and there's nothing like synapse maintenance, but that synapses are continuously destroyed and reformed, either at a small scale or a large scale, depending on the brain region. But that's arguable. That's just a hypothesis. It's been shown only by in vivo imaging for the hippocampus by two different labs.
So, one more question, just since I'm chairing the session. You were showing that, at least it looked for me, that the you need one latrophilin molecule interacts with two with Flirt and Tunerin, do you need like this bimodal interaction, or you need on one synapse you can have like two molecules, one binding to Flirt is binding to one molecule and Tunerin to another, or you really need like both of them binding to one receptor?
Victor, that's an incredibly insightful question, because we don't know, and we've been wondering about the same thing, and it's at the very heart of thinking about signaling. Do you need separate activation by different ligands, or do you need simultaneous activation by different ligands? A very important question. I have no idea how to test this at present. Well, I have an idea, but we haven't done it yet. Yeah, and which would be to separately express the different two different mutants and see if they, you co-express, then you can rescue it. That could answer that question. It's a very interesting question, yeah.
What do we need the proteolysis for?
I have no idea. Our result has not been well received by the field because people want the proteolysis to be important.
And I'm really sorry for these questions, but I hope there will be questions which you can answer.
Last year, you published a nice paper about genes involved in learning and memory in fear conditioning. Between these genes, any genes which are involved in control or producing or epigenetic regulation of latrophilins?
I don't know whether they are involved in the epigenetic regulation. I appreciate your kind comment about the paper. It was really the first time something like that had been done. And as the first time something like this is done, it's always inherently preliminary. What I mean with that is that it highlights the fact that we actually don't know for most genes in the genome what they really do. And so there's now all these collections of genes by transcriptomics that people highlight, but really we don't know what these genes do. And so I can't exclude that any of these genes are actually involved in regulating latrophilins, but there's nothing that sticks out. There's nothing that I could point to and say, yes, this is how it works. So what I believe is that we are soon going to enter the post-transcriptomic stage, where we go from actually all these papers that we and others publish on transcriptomic changes. And let's face it, these papers are relatively easy because you just basically, I was surprised how easy this kind of stuff is. And you really now have to drill down and figure out what these genes actually mean and how they actually relate to the biology. And I'm embarrassed to say, I have no clue. So that is the challenge. The biology is always much more difficult than the transcriptomics, proteomics, whatever, which is much easier because you get lots of data very quickly. Now we need to figure out what's actually happening. And I hope we get to that point.
Last question from my side. So I know that at least Flirt-UNC interaction is a bit of specific. So you have differences in affinity between different Flirts and different UNCs. What about latrophilins? So do they interact with the same affinity with different receptors?
Great question. You know, this is a question that has been very much on top of our mind. It's a question that also applies actually to other adhesion interactions. Never been done properly, never been studied. Not for neurexins, not for latrophilins. We don't actually know whether Flirts and UNCs, UNC5s and latrophilins and tenurins, whether they're specific pairings. And one way to think about specificity, actually our leading hypothesis, is that different specificities are encoded by distinct affinities. And in a totally different paper that we just published a couple of months ago in Nature, we showed, for example, that this is likely what operates in instructing synaptic properties, again, in the hippocampus, in a neurexin-based interaction pairing. So we think that affinities are key, but they're very difficult to measure. and it takes a lot of work. And once you measure them, no journal will want to publish them because they say it's descriptive. It is descriptive, but it's essential to know.
I really apologize for abusing my role today. So I hope that there will be questions from the rest of the audience. So please.
I think everything was so clear that nobody.
So any questions or comments?
Or criticisms, come on.
So I'm not an expert in this field, but could it be that epigenetic memory inside the neuron works like the following, that somehow signaling induces DNA methylation of these genes, which are responsible for the organization of this vehicle, and that's why controls the activity of the neuron?
Yeah, absolutely. I think very much so. I believe that epigenetic changes are likely to have a big part in memory. I also think that another aspect of this is alternative splicing. Alternative splicing turns out to regulate synapses via orexins enormously to a large degree. Remember that alternative splicing in the system that I discussed with you today, the latrophilin-based interactions, also plays a major role. Both tenurins and latrophilins are alternatively spliced extensively. And that too is likely to have an effect. So I think that epigenetic changes could play a major role, although I don't think it's via DNA methylation, because that seems to be fairly static from all I can tell. It's more likely via other epigenetic mechanisms. Nevertheless, it's epigenetic, and I think that that's one area of research which will have a major impact in future.
So if we have no more questions, then I hope that I will express the wish of the audience to have those answers to those questions you didn't answer today in 2 years from now on Volga on the boat. We hope that you'll accept our invitation in 2 years from now to come on the boat and have more time to discuss. So you are going to have the same link. So would be great if you can follow the meeting next 3 days and contribute to the discussion. The entire meeting will be in English. So once again, thank you, Tom, very much for your great talk and for coming tonight.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. And have a wonderful evening.
Thank you. So once again, I think the scientific part is over now. And I was told that we're going to have a photo session, but I'm not sure. It's dark outside. Is it now or tomorrow? Okay, that means we are basically going somewhere. Okay, we'll try. We'll make a first try tonight, so to make a group photo. If it doesn't work, so we'll repeat it tomorrow. Again, thank you very much, and I wish you a nice stay here.
Thank you. Коллеги, фотограф сказал, что он все-таки не волшебник, поэтому давайте попробуем сделать фото около сцены. Да, и может быть завтра мы еще раз попробуем уже на улице, но прошу всех сюда. Все-таки фотограф, он немножко волшебник. Уважаемые коллеги, подойдите сюда к сцене. Это, конечно, намного сложнее, чем на улицу, но мы с вами попробуем встать вот так вот полукругом. Вот, полукруг может быть достаточно большим. Значит, смотрите, девушки, высокие девушки, встают на сцену. Девушки есть у нас в зале? Подходите сюда, пожалуйста. Елена Вадимовна, обязательно. Так, все девушки встают наверх. Высокие девушки встают в середину. Вот. Так, девушки, которые повыше высоких девушек, встают в промежутке между высокими девушками. Так, размещайтесь, пожалуйста. Но немного, значит, сюда вот еще встаем, перед сценой. Не стесняйтесь, пожалуйста, подходите, будем думать, как вас всех разместить. Идите, 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 не бойтесь. Антон, вставайте, пожалуйста. Владимир, персональное приглашение. Денис.
Corriera dal cuore zelante, capelli come rose rosse,
preziosi
quei fili di rame, amore, portali. Se senti campane cantare, vedrai coralline che piange, prende il dolore degli altri e poi lo porta dentro lei. Coraline, coraline, dimmi le tue verità. Coraline, coraline, dimmi le tue verità. Coraline, coraline, dimmi le tue verità.
Coraline,
coraline, però lei sa la verità. Non è per tutti andare avanti con il cuore che è diviso in due metà. È freddo già, è una bambina però sente come un peso e prima o poi si spezzerà e la gente dirà non vale niente, non riesce neanche a uscire da una misera porta. Ma un giorno, una volta lei ci riuscirà.
Coraline
che può crescere, prendere le sue cose e poi partire. Ma sento un mostro che la tiene in gabbia, che le ricopre la strada di mine. Ho detto a Coraline che può crescere, prendere le sue cose e poi partire. Ma Coraline non vuole mangiare, no. Se Coraline vorrebbe sparire, e Coraline piange, Coraline all'ansia, Coraline vuole il mare ma ha paura dell'acqua, e forse il mare è dentro di lei. Se ogni parola è un'ascia, un taglio sulla schiena, come una zattera che naviga in un fiume in piena, e forse il fiume è dentro di lei. Di lei.
Так, и можно музыку выключить, пожалуйста? Я, конечно, говорю громко, но меня, наверное, не слышно. Так, 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 так.
Sarò il fuoco ed il freddo, riparo d'inverno, sarò ciò che respiri, capirò cosa hai detto e sarò l'acqua da bere, significato del bene, sarò anche un soldato o la luce di sera e in cambio non chiedo niente, soltanto un sorriso. Ogni tua piccola lacrima è oceano sopra il mio viso, e in cambio non chiedo niente, solo un po' di tempo. Sarò un vessillo scudo o la tua spada d'argento. E Coraline piange, Coraline all'ansia, Coraline vuole il mare ma ha paura dell'acqua, e forse il mare è dentro di lei. E ogni parola è un'ascia, un taglio sulla piena, come una zattera che naviga in un fiume in piena, e forse il fiume è dentro di lei, di lei. Coraline, Coraline, dimmi le tue verità. Coraline, Coraline, dimmi le tue verità. Coraline, Coraline, dimmi le tue verità. Coraline, Coraline, bella come il sole. Ho perso il frutto del suo ventre, non ha conosciuto l'amore. Un padre che ti padrà niente, le han detto in città c'è un castello. Con mura talmente potenti, che se ci va a vivere dentro, potrà colpirti più niente. Potrà colpirti più
niente. Да, во, отлично. Так, я вас не увижу.
Without you, without you, oh, oh, wow. got this right.